Short summary of the science case, concept, and expected performances of the Transient High Energy Sky and the Universe Surveyor, TSEUS, which is an acronym, which is a mission concept being developed by a large European collaboration led by Italy, especially actually under evaluation by ESA within the Cosmic Vision program for next M5 mission, which should be launched at the end of the 20s. And here you can find more detailed information on the website and in the white papers, especially this one focuses on the key role that this mission may have, if selected, for multi-messenger astrophysics. The consortium is coordinated by five countries at least, Italy, UK, France, Germany, and Switzerland, with contribution by many other European countries and active interest by some groups in the USA, leader groups like the Huntsville people in Alabama, contributing to the GBM and to the BETH experiment, and also China and Brazil. So the main goals of TSEUS are to fully exploit gamma ray burst, so this very important phenomenon for modern astrophysics and science, especially to explore the high redshift universe, given their huge luminosity association with the death of massive stars and redshift distribution up to the so-called end of the Dark Ages, so a few hundred million years after the Big Bang, we are talking about redshift of 10, 12, or even more, gamma ray bursts are potentially a very powerful tool to explore the evolution of metallicity, star formation rate, ionization, and the formation of first stars and galaxies. At the same time, TSEUS aims at monitoring the X-ray sky, the soft X-ray sky, up to the soft gamma ray sky with a unique combination of large field of view. This is the one of the two half of the error region of the first gravitational wave event detected by LIGO, huge error region, but TSEUS will be capable of covering such a large error region instantaneously, and to have a sensitivity capable to detecting several classes of transient sources. More specifically, for the early universe science, we want to exploit the huge luminosity of gamma ray bursts that makes them visible up to huge redshift values, their association with the death of massive stars. These stars live and die where they were born, so they are very important tracer star formation rate, which in turn is a powerful tool to understand the physics and sources of ionization, one of the still more mysterious open issues in modern cosmology, and to study the metallicity evolution throughout the whole cosmic history, and to detect and study the first population of stars. Just to give an example, this is the infrared counterpart of the highest redshift ever detected. So we could detect this light from, this is a direct detection of an object at a redshift of 9.2. This is a few hundred million years after the Big Bang, without any lensing or any other kind of thing, like some galaxies have been detected at higher redshift, but through lensing and so on. This is a direct detection. And we know that there, in that direction, at that redshift, there is a star, there was a star exploding, there is a very high redshift galaxy, only because we were able to detect, localize accurately this very high redshift gamma ray burst, and to follow up very quickly it with large telescopes in order to detect this fading counterpart. So by simply counting, if we could get a statistical sample of this gamma ray burst at a redshift higher than 6, 7, up to a redshift of 10, we could easily, simply counting, discriminating the extrapolation of the star formation rate at redshift higher than 6 and 7, that as you can see, there is a lot of huge uncertainty on how the star formation rate goes at redshift higher than 6, which is a very important in order to understand if actually the first stars were capable of reionizing the universe. At the same time, if you look, these are the six fields of six gamma ray bursts at redshift higher than 6. These are Hubble images, Hubble Space Telescope images, and there is, as you can see, nothing. When this source, the afterglow, following the gamma ray burst disappears, the Hubble Space Telescope, or the largest telescopes in the world, can see nothing. This means that we know that here there are galaxies only because we could detect and the gamma ray burst exploding there. So the very magic of gamma ray burst is that if we are capable of doing absorption spectroscopy of the fading counterpart before it fades away, of these galaxies that we don't see, these invisible galaxies, we can learn the metallicity, the neutral hydrogen fraction, and even the composition of the ionization degree of the intergalactic medium of these galaxies that are invisible. So only through gamma ray burst we can actually get a statistical sample and measurements of the evolution of the neutral hydrogen fraction in the very early galaxies, the metallicity evolution from the first galaxies up to the more recent epochs, and so on. What we need, clearly, is to increase substantially of more than one order of magnitude the number of gamma ray bursts detected at redshift higher than 6. Up to now, we have less than 10 gamma ray bursts, as you can see. This is the redshift distribution. So, first objective of TCUs is to get a statistical sample, 150 gamma ray bursts at redshift higher than 6. The second phase of the science case of TCUs, which is more concerning the thematics of this work, of course, is to provide a substantial contribution to multi-messenger astrophysics and time-domain astronomy by monitoring the soft X-ray sky with a huge, with a unique combination of a large field of view. We're talking about more than one steradian instantaneously, a sensitivity which is much beyond orders of magnitude better than previously flown X-ray monitors, and an energy band extending up to 1 MeV or even more. And this will allow TCUs to detect many, many classes of transients, localize them with a few arc minutes location accuracy or even better, and thus be fully complementary and very synergic with the large observational facilities in the electromagnetic domain of the next decade, SKA, ELT, ATINA, and so on, and also with the multi-messenger facilities, gravitational wave next generation observatories like Advanced LIGO, Virgo, LISA, Einstein's telescope, and so on. Just to give an idea of what we are aiming at, and this will be feasible, this is the combination of observation for the first neutron star, neutron star merger event detected in a gravitational wave event. So there is the localization and localization by LIGO, Virgo, the gamma ray burst, the kilonova, and what TCUs, so this detection required the combination of and the efforts of many, many observatories in the world, but TCUs will be capable by itself to simultaneously detect the short gamma ray burst, to localize it at a few arc minutes or even down to one arc second, to detect the kilonova emission, and to detect the possible soft X-ray emission associated with neutron star, neutron star mergers if they produce, for instance, a long-living millisecond pulsar of magnetar. This is possible through a unique combination of instrumentation and mission profile. So TCUs will carry on board a soft X-ray monitor constituted of lobster eye cameras. These lobster eye cameras are focusing optics with huge field of view. So they exploit microchannel plates in a peculiar configuration, and they are capable to focus soft X-rays up to 5-6 kV and to get a source location accuracy of a few arc minutes and a sensitivity which is of the order of focusing telescope. So usually focusing telescope have 10-30 arc minutes at most of field of view. The energy band of this soft X-ray monitor is complemented in order to extend the capabilities of detection and monitoring the sky up to several MeV, for instance, by a so-called X-gamma ray imaging spectrometer, which is the instrument for which Italy would provide the know-how and the technology. This is an instrument whose prototypes are already being developed and exploits the research and development funded by ASI, INAF, and ANFN. So this is a very efficient and good way to exploit all these technological developments. It is a coded mask instrument based on silicon dive detectors coupled to scintillators, which allow to cover a broad energy band from 2 kV up to as many MeV with a large field of view. And then there is an infrared telescope. So the idea is that these monitors will localize gamma ray, detect the localized gamma ray burst transients, and command the slewing of the spacecraft. So the spacecraft will be a swift-like spacecraft that will be capable of slewing to the an infrared telescope to the position of the source within a few minutes. The infrared telescope is a 70 centimeter primary mirror Schmidt-Cassegrain telescope working in the near infrared from 0.8 to 1.82 microns with both imaging and spectroscopy, moderate spectroscopic capabilities. So this combination of instrumentation and mission profile will allow TESIUS to detect every class of gamma ray burst. So this is a way of showing the spectral hardness of gamma ray burst with respect to the peak flux. And TESIUS, so this is what is presently done by the Fermi Gamma Ray Burst Monitor. So present detectors are limited to this region. TESIUS will extend the capability of detecting gamma ray burst to every type of gamma ray burst. So high redshift gamma ray bursts, which are weak and soft, short gamma ray bursts, like the counterpart of gravitational wave signals from neutron star neutron star mergers, gamma ray bursts associated with supernovae, ultra long gamma ray bursts, under luminous gamma ray bursts, all the classes of gamma ray bursts which have a main role for both cosmology and multi messenger astrophysics. At the same time, as I mentioned before, by combining the unprecedented sensitivity and the broad field of view of the soft X-ray imager compared to other X-ray focusing telescope, TESIUS will be capable of detecting hundreds of transients over a broad field of view, localizing them, and importantly, to measure also for many of them the redshift through the measurements of the infrared telescope. This for the early universe. The important figure is the number of gamma ray bursts as a function of redshift that will be detected in one per year or in 3 years of operation. This is our examples. And this is what is done presently thanks to the SWIFT observations combined with the optical infrared follow-up. And this is what TESIUS will be capable to. So there is a substantial improvement in the efficiency in detecting, localizing, and measuring the redshift of high redshift gamma ray bursts. This will convert, for instance, in this accuracy, in this yellow dot with these small errors, in the estimate of the star formation rate as a function of redshift. More in general, for the universe science, TESIUS by itself will detect hundreds of gamma ray bursts, localize them at even arc-second location accuracy thanks to the detection of the infrared afterglow with the infrared telescope, measure the redshift for many of them, and thus combining its measurements with the follow-up with the large next-generation facilities like ELT, TMT in the optical, or ATINA, for instance, in the X-ray, combine spectroscopic measurements and imaging in order to get the goals of investigating the metallicity evolution, studying the first population of stars, studying the physics and evolution of ionization. Concerning multi-messenger astrophysics, again, there are several kinds of so-called, for instance, gravitational wave sources that may be detected by TESIUS in the electromagnetic regime. But let's focus again on the neutron star, neutron star, neutron star black hole mergers, which are the most likely to be detected, because, as demonstrated by the gravitational wave of the 17th of August, they are associated with the production of short gamma ray bursts, and TESIUS will be very efficient in detecting and localizing short gamma ray bursts, as well it will be efficient in detecting and localizing the soft X-ray emission produced, possibly produced by these neutron star and neutron star mergers. And this is again the idea on how it will be capable to monitor a field of view much larger than the typical errors that we will get by advanced gravitational wave detectors, and arrive to a localization of a few arc minutes through the short gamma ray burst, for instance, but by detecting the infrared afterglow or the kilonova. This is the kilonova associated with GW170817, and this is the sensitivity imaging and spectroscopic sensitivity of TESIUS. So TESIUS, for an event like this one, will be capable of detecting it, localizing it, at a 1 arc second position within a few minutes from the detection, or within an hour at most, and also do some preliminary spectroscopy for the identification. And this will allow the further refinement, for instance, of the position down to 1 arcsecond. So what now requires this huge effort, a combination of ground, space, telescopes, and so on, could be done by TCUs very efficiently for many, many transients, many gravitational wave signals, within a few minutes or a few hours. And this is, again, the synergy for multi-messenger astrophysics of TCUs with the large electromagnetic facilities or the next generation gravitational wave detectors like the Einstein telescope. I would like to conclude by stressing the relevance of this kind of mission also for more general astrophysical purposes. Having such a flexible infrared and also a soft X-ray observatory in space, as demonstrated by SWIFT in the X-ray regime, will allow a lot of observatory science because it will give the community at large the possibility of quick TO observations of many classes of transients or programs of follow-up or large samples of many sources, say AGN or cold stars, even exoplanets and so on. So there will be a huge involvement of the community as demonstrated by the SWIFT mission in the X-rays. And I just conclude stressing that TCUs is also a unique occasion to exploit the heritage and leadership of Europe and Italy in particular in the field of gamma ray burst and multi-messenger astrophysics and time domain astronomy at large, and through the instrumental contribution to exploit the research and technology investments that Italy has done through INAF, ASI, INFN. More information can be found again in the website and the white papers. And the present status of the selection process of the M5 mission is that TCUs passed the technical evaluation. So despite it may look as a bit a complex mission with all these instruments, an infrared telescope in low Earth orbit, which is not an ideal environment, and this fast moving capability, which is necessary to follow up immediately the sources, it was evaluated to be feasible. And now the scientific evaluation is should be concluded within, I think, 1 month or even before, so we should know how it comes. In any case, I think that such a mission concept should be pursued and developed for any kind of opportunity. In the United States, there is a similar concept, which is the Transient Astrophysics Probe, which has been selected for a preliminary study for the Decadal Survey. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Lorenzo.
Lorenzo, at the beginning of the talk, you addressed the point that for far gamma ray burst, high Z gamma ray burst, you have seen you can use Teseus for the baryonic to study the baryonic content on the early universe, while Hubble will not see anything. Is that in some way true also for James Webb, or James Webb can work in parallel or in synergy with
this? This is true. Of course, we are. If the selected Zeus will fly after JWST, after so at the end of the 20s, and of course this was one of the main points that we discussed in the proposal and with ESA, the Hubble Space Telescope. Gamma ray burst. That will be detectable and localizable by TCUs, will provide us with the detection and characterization of galaxies that are under the threshold of the Hubble Space Telescope, and many of them will also be under the threshold of the James Webb Space Telescope, because clearly it is still very uncertain how the faint end of the luminosity function of galaxies is going. No? This is also one of the aims of TCUs. But it is expected that the bulk of star formation rate at very high redshift is in galaxies which are below the threshold of these very large facilities also of the future. And this is why it is of key importance to exploit gamma ray burst. The cosmology community agrees, of course, with this case. They are simply In the last 10, 20 years, since we have the possibility of measuring the ratio of the gamma ray burst, they expected that the number of gamma ray bursts at high ratio could be much higher. And this is only the only one thing that is preventing to fully exploit gamma ray bursts for cosmology, is that up to now we have no more than 1 or 0.5 gamma ray bursts per year at high ratio. But with this use, with this combination, we will have 150 gamma ray bursts in 3 years at ratio higher than 6, 30 gamma ray bursts at ratio higher than 8. So the studies will be fully complementary. Yes. Also for ionization, so there will be also SKA studying ionization through the 21 centimeter line, but this will study the topology of ionization, while Theseus will study the if stars, the first stars will were capable of sustaining ionization, which means knowing how many stars there were, and what is the ultraviolet escape fraction of those galaxies, because you need that the ultraviolet photons produced by the galaxies, that by these four stars escape the galaxy and ionize the intergalactic medium.
So this okay.
Was, more than answer was another talk. Second. Yes.
You mentioned several times the fact that Theseus will be very important also to constrain the metal evolution, the chemical evolution of the universe. But maybe this is naive, but I expect this will probe essentially the metallicity which is either local to the gamma ray burst or along the line of sight of the gamma ray burst. So maybe strongly biased with respect to the metallicity evolution overall, the metallicity evolution of the universe.
There are, this method has been, of course, calibrated with lower redshift galaxies, you know? So up to now, at lower redshift, of course, you can combine the information that you obtain through absorption spectroscopy of the afterglow of the gamma ray burst and the galaxies. So what comes out is that the information that you get on metallicity from the gamma ray burst in the infrared, optical infrared, is characterizing the whole galaxies, the whole of the galaxy. Instead, in the X-rays, for instance, you tend to monitor the local environment. And this is a very powerful synergy with, I should have a very quickly a slide, with Athena. This is another example of the synergy. This is an infrared spectrum on the left for tracing the metallicity and neutral hydrogen fraction of as measured infrared of those galaxies, and this is the metallicity as would be measured by Athena following a trigger localization and redshift. So Athena has this kind of studies as one of its main goals, but needs some machine like Theseus to tell what gamma ray burst to follow. And this information, where is the gamma ray burst? The localization with even one arc second accuracy and the redshift is fundamental.
Okay, thank you, Lorenzo.
Okay. Thank you very much.